Good morning. How are you? Does it feel like November to you? Because it is. September went really, really fast, I think. But happy November. We're glad you're here for worship. Big news for today is Pastor Phil is preaching at Hebron, so Pastor Jeff is here to bring us the message this morning. And then there's some other meetings that are a couple Sunday school classes and things that are happening today. Please check your bulletin to see what the schedule is. But next Sunday, look, I had to make notes. Look at this. It's a lot going on next Sunday. So I'm going to try and hit the hot spots for you. First thing, big thing, next Sunday, worship at both campuses is moving indoors. So we will be back inside. Hebron is going to be at 9:30, and Pole Green will be at 9 o'clock. And then Sunday school and all those kind of activities that are already established are going to be starting up. We're not restarting Sunday school inside yet for everybody. But we'll be broadcasting to the parking lot still. We'll still be doing Facebook Live, and we'll also be adding to the Pole Green worship to the website come Monday or Tuesday, depending on when I'm in the office and how quickly I get it from Zach. So that's how that works. You can also find any past worship services on the website. So if you missed one or you liked one and you want to go back and hear it again, they're all out there for you. Also next Sunday, the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes are due. There's wonderful stacks of them in the Commons right now, but please don't forget to bring your shoebox. You can drop it by any time this week, or just make sure you have it with you next Sunday when you come to worship. There is a $9 shipping charge for each of those boxes, so maybe you couldn't get a box together, but you've got $9 in your pocket. You can drop that by too and just say that it's for the Operation Christmas Child Fund. Also, next Sunday, the 8th, there's a baptism service at 2 o'clock. It's here at the Pole Green campus. If you are interested in this service, if you've never been baptized or you want more information about it, please call Pastor Jeff or Pastor Phil and talk to them about that. It'll be at 2 o'clock. There'll be a little bit of music. I think I understood it might last about 30 minutes. So pretty quick if you want to come and watch the folks that are going to be baptized. Here's bullet point number 4. In as much teams, your choices are due by next Sunday. So get a brochure. You can get one right now today at the church. They might even have had them at, as you came through the circle. Figure out what you want to do. That event is next Saturday, the 14th, and it's at 8:30. We're going to be doing some mission projects, as many as we can, with the folks who sign up all around here at the church, but also out in the community. So get a brochure. They're online. You can email Phil with what group you want to be in. That way you can get everything planned out. If you can't participate the day of in as much, there's lots of shopping and dropping that can happen this week. So go shopping. There's lists in your bulletin of things that are needed. The Commons right now is like a maze. You have to jump over things and do the ninja moves to get through the Commons and the glass doors right now. So thank you, but keep bringing that stuff so we can get all of those Thanksgiving bags done for folks around the area who need them. If you haven't already done it, plug into a Sunday school class. Find one. They're meeting on Zoom. They're meeting in person. They're meeting in people's homes. Check out the calendar that's attached to the website, but also look around in the bulletin and talk to people, because there's a bunch of people here that are going to Sunday school, and you need to be a part of that. In fact, Paul, where did you move? Over there. Paul Rush, he's hosting at 10 o'clock over in the community building. We're having a wonderful wander through Matthew. Might take until after Easter to wander all the way through it, but hey, it's a great class and some great fellowship time too. Here's something. If you can't get here for a Sunday school lesson, or you don't want to go to Sunday school with grown-ups, fine. Go to Sunday school with your kids, because there are some great lessons, and I'm not patting myself on the back because God was all up in this. But out on our website are online Sunday school lessons that started in September. And I'm a grown-up, and I've been teaching Bible stuff for like a bunch of years. I don't even want to date myself. But I'm learning something every time I'm doing one of these lessons. There is meat here, folks, for grown-ups and for kids. So find a kid, if you don't have one in your house, do a Sunday school lesson, one of these lessons online. Everything you need is there. You can download it. If you have issues with internet or internet speed, or you don't have a printer, call me, text me, email me, and I will put a packet together with the DVD, all of the lesson materials that you need, and you can plug in and really dig into the Old Testament. Come Christmas, we're going to do a couple of Christmas stories, and then the first of the year, we're going to turn the page and go into the New Testament and be looking at some of Jesus's ministry and miracles and all of that kind of stuff. So it's really exciting for me as a teacher and a minister to do it a different way and to be able to reach more people. So please take advantage. It's free, it's out there, it's waiting for you, and you will be blessed by it. There's more stuff going on beyond next Sunday, but I don't have time for that. So we're gonna stop there, take a deep breath, and get ready for worship. So pray with me if you will, please. Father God, we are here. It's raining a little bit, might be a little bit chilly. We're in the car, we're in the house, we're in the pavilion. But we are here in your house, and we are your church, and we're gathered here to worship you today. So help us to do that. Help us to clear our minds, to calm our spirit, to open up our hearts, to listen, to participate, to be involved, to get engaged, to be moved by what we hear, to be moved to do something different, to be changed. Lord, help us with that today. We open ourselves up to you. We stand here. And we're going to be still, and we're going to wait and see what you do. We love you, Lord. We lift our praises to you now. We pray this in your Son's precious name. Amen.
Good morning. I'd like to invite you this time to stand, if you're able, as we sing Standing on the Promises of God.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all and all. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, y'all. I'm going to be reading from Exodus chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Meanwhile, Moses was shepherding the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire within a bush. As Moses looked, he saw that the bush was on fire but was not consumed. So Moses thought, I must go over and look at this remarkable sight. Why isn't the bush burning up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called out to him from the bush, Moses, Moses. Here I am, he answered. Do not come closer, he said. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground.
be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He is holy. Be still, O restless soul of mine, bow before the Prince of Peace. Let the noise and clamor cease. Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He is faithful. Consider all that He has done. Stand in awe and be amazed, and know that He will never change. And be still. And be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He is God. Be still. Be speechless. Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know He is our Father. Come rest your head upon His breast. Listen to the rhythm of His unfailing heart of love, beating for His little ones, calling each of us to come and be still.
Thank y'all so much, praise team, sound team, everybody who got here early to set up so we could gather as a family of Christ and worship. Let's give them a big round of applause. Let's hear it in the cars. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Let's say that one more time. Let's give them a big round of applause from the cars. There we go. Before I jump into the sermon this morning, I just want to say, tell you how much your church family at Hebron appreciates our Paul Green family for all that you do for our King William campus. Without your love and support, it would be next to impossible to maintain the ministry that God has laid before. So we want to say thank you for the people who give their time and talents to help us at Hebron. We want to thank you for your prayers, your donations of food for our food pantry that we're beginning. And our youth wanted me to be sure to thank Tyson for his midweek Tuesday evening services. I know we cannot express how grateful we are for our brothers and sisters here at Paul Green. Today we're talking about Wake Up, For God Is Calling. And about a century ago, a century and a half ago, the telegraph was by far the fastest means of communication. And there was a young man who answered an ad for a job as a telegraph operator. When he got there, there was seven men waiting, and it was a really large and busy office. The clicking and clacking of the telegraph was going on in the background. There was a sign at the receptionist desk that told the applicants to please sit down, fill out a form, and once they had finished it, they would be summoned for an interview. Well, the other seven men had already filled out the form, and this one sat down and began writing. And after he finished his form, a couple minutes later, he got up and walked across the room opened up the private door, and walked through. The other seven wondered. They're like, who is this guy? What's he doing? He didn't wait. He just walked right in. I bet they throw him out right away. Well, just a couple minutes later, the employer walked out. He was smiling and laughing and looked at the other seven and said, you can go. We found our candidate. And the candidates, there were some grumbling. They were mad. And one of them said, hold on, wait a minute. We've been waiting patiently. We did exactly as we were told. We sat down, we filled out our form, and we waited for somebody to call us. And the man smiled. He said, in the telegraphs that's been going off, it says, once you finish filling out your form, come on in. The job is yours. He was the only one that listened. You know, just like these seven men, we live in a world where there's constant noise, there's constant talking, and often it's easy to miss God's voice. We have the TV, the radio, our computers, our smartphones. We've got to listen to our boss. We have to listen to our spouse. If we're a child, we have to listen to our parents and our teachers and our coaches. We're supposed to listen to our friends, but with so much going on and so many voices out there, we often miss what God has to say. I want to take you back for a few moments to the Old Testament times when Israel was in the Promised Land, but before they had a king, before they had a temple. We call this the time of the judges. And during the days of the judges, Shiloh was the place where the Jews gathered to worship. The tabernacle was set up there. The Ark of the Covenant was kept in its walls. And Eli was the high priest at the time. And he had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And they were serving as priests under their father. And they were being groomed to take charge after he passed away. But Scripture tells us they were scoundrels. So God made another plan for the spiritual leadership of his people. You see, every year this family came, and the father's name was Elkaniah, and he came to worship at Shiloh, and his wife Hannah would come with him. And actually, I shouldn't have said father because they didn't have any children. You see, despite all the years of trying and fervent prayer for children, they still did not have a child. But then on one occasion while worshiping at Shiloh, Hannah prayed once again. And she promised God that if he gave her a son, she would dedicate him to God for the rest of his life. And God answered her prayers, and Samuel was born. And he was raised with Elkanah and Hannah until he was old enough to be a helper at Shiloh. And then she brought him to Eli, and the tabernacle became little Samuel's home. And his parents would visit him as often as they could, but God had a plan for Samuel to grow up as a great prophet and priest and judge for Israel. So let's take a look at what happens to this little boy and what changed his life when he was still very young. It's in Samuel 3, 1 Samuel 3, 1 through 10. And it says this, the boy Samuel ministered before God under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare, and there were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the house of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, here I am. And he ran to Eli and said, here I am, you called me? But Eli said, I didn't call you. Go lie down. So he went. And he lay down. And again the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up. And he went to Eli and said, here I am. You called me? My son, Eli said, I did not call you. Go back and lie down. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. A third time the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am. You called me. Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down. And if he calls you, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Then the Lord called. Then the Lord came and stood there, calling as the other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. You know, this is kind of a funny story. We can almost picture old Eli laying there, young Samuel not understanding what's going on. But the story does not start with humor. It starts very sadly. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare, and there were not many visions. Was God being silent, or was it that they were not listening? Maybe the more important question is, are we listening today? We know Eli's sons, they weren't listening. 1 Samuel tells us that they had no respect for the Lord. They did what they wanted to do and when they wanted to do it. They ignored the sacred work of God that he called them to. Scripture tells us they were lazy, mean, immoral, and greedy. The Bible says that our sins come between us and God, and that's what was definitely happening with these two young men. In John 8:47 says, "He who belongs to God hears what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God." But what about the others who weren't hearing? What about Eli the priest? What about the religious people who came to Shiloh to worship? Maybe they were too busy to really seek a message from God. We all live the same life. We're busy with our families. We have to take care of them. We have to make a living. Maybe they were just too busy to listen. How many of you have ever been to the Great Plains? Maybe to Standing Rock, maybe just some other time. Who's been there? Anybody? If you've ever been to the Great Plains, it's very quiet. It's very still. It's not at all like our cities. Well, this Native American man, he'd come to New York City to visit with a friend, and he walked back and he was taken aback by the noise, the cars, the horns, the yelling, the sirens, just the roar of so many people walking down the street. And one day he's walking with his friends and he says, "I hear a cricket." And the friend said, "Yeah, right." And he said, "No, I'm serious, there's a cricket." And he started looking around, he said, "It's over there." And he went to this flower pot and started digging through it, and sure enough, he found a cricket. And the man said, "You must have superhuman hearing." And he said, "No, my hearing's just like yours. You see, it depends on what you're listening to." You see, people hear what they want to hear. He said, "I'll show you." And they're walking down the street, and he pulls a change out of his pocket and lets it drop to the ground. And even with all the noise, all the roar of the crowd, all the cars, the trucks, everybody within 25 feet turned to look at the coins that were falling on the ground. And the Indian says, "See what I mean? It all depends on what you're listening for." Perhaps the people in this time were waiting for God to speak. Maybe they wanted him to speak in this grand, outrageous ways that he had spoken to others. Maybe they wanted God to speak to them through angels like he did to Abraham. Or maybe he wanted to speak to them through dreams like he did for Joseph. Or maybe they wanted to see a burning bush like Moses did. Or maybe they wanted God to speak to them through a donkey like he did to Balaam. And maybe God will speak to you through a donkey today. But most likely he's going to speak to you through a still and quiet voice. Maybe he's going to speak to you through a fellow believer. Maybe he's going to speak to you when you read scripture or through seeing him at work. And what would happen if God spoke to you in some miraculous way? I would like to think it would get our attention, but it also wouldn't require any real faith. We wouldn't have to dive into scripture. We wouldn't have to see God at work. You see, God wants to speak to us, but he gets to choose his means of communication. You know, there's a great story about the prophet Elijah that reminds us that God sometimes speaks very simply and very quietly. Elijah wanted to hear from God, so God led him up to a mountain. And there was a powerful wind, and it was so strong that it broke the rocks in the mountain, but God wasn't in the wind. And then the mountain shook from the power of an earthquake, but God was not in the earthquake. And then there was a great fire, but God was not in the fire. But then there came a gentle whisper. Scripture calls it a still, small voice. And Elijah realized that God was then going to talk to him. I'm sure you've heard that story before. It's in 1 Kings 19. But how does God speak to us today? You know, I have a really good friend from seminary, and he just became a Christian in college, so he hadn't been a believer all that long. And he said that when he first accepted Christ, he would hear God speaking to him very clearly and very plainly. And he said it wasn't an out loud voice, but he would hear him clearly in his mind. And he said, I never hear his voice anymore. What's wrong? And I told him, I said, you know, that's a question for God, and only he can answer. But maybe God expects you to grow and to know his character. Maybe he wants to speak to you through Scripture or through other Christians, or maybe he wants you to know his will and then figure out the specifics. And yes, God can speak to us through angels or visions or dreams, but he probably doesn't do that as often as he speaks through that still and quiet voice. But there are some ways that God speaks to us really regularly. He speaks to us through creation. He speaks to us about his existence, his power, and his creativity, but it's not a real personal message. He speaks to us through the Bible whenever we pick it up and read. He speaks to us through other Christians. And he speaks to us through that quiet voice of his Holy Spirit who moves our conscience and our thoughts. Maybe a conviction of sin that sits on your heart is a message from God. And maybe someone that's on your mind that you should visit or call, maybe that's a message from God. Maybe that ministry that God keeps on your mind, maybe that's a message from God that you need to be a part of that ministry. But I do know this, that there are times that we're most likely to hear from God. I think when we ask for forgiveness and keep a clear conscience, we're very likely to hear from God. When we study things that God says in the Bible, we're likely to hear from God. When we give God some special time, you know, Psalms 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. And when we practice praying on a regular basis, when we do what Scripture says, pray without ceasing, we're likely to hear from God. You see, God will give us our focus, and we always need to be on the lookout or the listen out for what he's saying. How many of you in your little search for four-leaf clovers? Anybody? Just a couple. All right. Well, when you look for a four-leaf clover, you find them most likely when you're very patient. When you're focused on looking for that clover with four leaves and not three. When you take the time and spend it, that's when you're most likely to find the four-leaf clover. You know what? When you're patient, when you're focused, and you spend time listening for God to speak, that's when you're most likely to hear his word. It's kind of like a mother who can pick out her baby's cry because she's so familiar with it and she cares so much about her baby. In John 10, Jesus compares himself to a good shepherd and says, he calls his sheep by name and leads them out, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. In your own life, you want to come to know the ways of God and how he speaks to you. The first thing you need to be able to do is recognize his voice. But back to that story of Samuel. Three times God called Samuel. And three times Samuel thinks it's Eli. And he goes to someone who's older and wiser and closer to God. And Eli is then wise enough to give Samuel the best advice of his life. And it's great advice for me and you today. If he calls, you say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And that's just what Samuel did. And God continued to speak to him throughout his life. You see, what God wants more than anything is to know that you're listening, that you want to know what he has to say, what he might need to tell you. In August of 2014, In May of 2014, I began praying to God, what would you have me do in my life? I was happy, I was content, but I felt God wanted me to do something more. And I prayed that prayer for about 5 months. In August, I filled in for a friend who was on vacation and preached for him, and somebody said, you should have been a pastor, you missed your calling. And I truly meant it, and I said, I cannot imagine a worse job than being a pastor. I have absolutely zero intention of ever being a pastor. But I kept praying that prayer. And in October, God told me, I want you to go to seminary. And I was still thinking, okay, he's not going to make me be a pastor. But I told my pastor, and I went and applied for seminary. You see, we have to want to hear God's voice. And it takes time often before we will hear it. You know, God might tell you what kind of good works you should be doing. If you ask God to speak to you, he might tell you to stop sinning. He might call you to a special ministry. He may also call you to turn your heart to Jesus. But I encourage you this, wake up. God is calling you. How are you going to answer him today? Let's pray. Father God, I'm not going to ask that you speak clear to us. Father, I ask that you help us to open our ears that we hear you. Father, help to open our eyes that we may see the beauty of your creation and see you at work in the world around us. Father, I ask that you open our hearts so that we can have compassion on a hurting world around us. Father, open our minds to take in the message from Scripture that you would have for us. Father, open our hearts that we may seek you and your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Is God talking to you today? Maybe saying that forgiveness thing I talk about, I meant that for you. That love your neighbor thing, I was talking to you. That love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength in your mind, I was talking to you. Or maybe saying I sent my son to earth to die for your sins, and you need to accept that gift of salvation. If you want to accept that gift, or if you need someone to pray with you, come as the praise team leads us in song.
God gives us his word to give us a guide through life. Would you join me as we sing the song, Thy Word? Stand if you're able. lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Let's take a few minutes and just still our hearts as we prepare for the Lord's Supper. Taking the Lord's Supper is one of the most unifying things we can do as a body of believers. The Apostle Paul warns us that we should examine ourselves before we partake of the Lord's Supper, because if we do this in an unworthy manner, we sin against the blood and body of Jesus Christ. But it's also the most unifying thing in our faith, because we come here as a group of sinners who have been saved by the grace and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father, we're overwhelmed by the love that you had for us when you sent your Son to earth to teach us, to minister to us, and to be a sacrifice for us. It was a job that he took on willingly, and he took on a faith that would lead to the pain and humiliation of the cross. But he did it to be a sacrifice for me and for you if we repent and accept his gift of salvation. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. Amen. Can't imagine what was going through Jesus' mind as he knew what awaited him the next few days. The cross, the pain, the humiliation, the being separated from his Father. But he went to his disciples and he broke this bread and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Praise team's going to lead us in a closing song.
Before we go, we'll sing "Blessed Be the Tie." Go. There's a little blue truck sitting over here. It's Kathy and Mike Tigner. They celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary yesterday. Can I give you a honk? You're dismissed.
Comes revival. Watch one tiny spark become.